It's Andre from High Performance Academy here. Let's check out what's been going on around HPA over the last week. We are still running our giveaway. Well, I say we're still running our giveaway, but we're running giveaways pretty much all the time. And if you're watching this at a later point on YouTube and the giveaway I'm about to cover no longer exists, not to worry. Head to hpacademy.com/giveaway. That will take you to our current giveaway. But speaking of that particular giveaway, we have partnered with the team at EMton. They've given us one of their EMton KV8s, which is a high-end motorsport spec ECU. As the 8 in the name KV8 would suggest, this is ideally suited to 8-cylinder engines, given that it has 8 injector and 8 ignition output, so it can control full sequential fuel injection on an 8-cylinder engine and, of course, direct spark. But don't let that stop you putting it on a 4-cylinder or a 6-cylinder as well. As I mentioned, it is a proper motorsport grade ECU, so if you're running a sequential gearbox or paddle shift and you want to control that through the ECU, absolutely up to the task. It'll also control traction control, anti-lag, basically anything that you would expect a high-end motorsport ECU to be able to do. This one is absolutely up to the task. We actually have one of these going into our Honda KRX race car, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, to replace the existing EMton SL4 for a variety of reasons. But this is an absolutely great ECU, so if you are currently building a project car and you're thinking about an ECU, this is the perfect time to get involved. I'll get the guys to drop a link into the comments that you can follow. This will take you through to the screen on my laptop here. You can see exactly what is involved in this giveaway. So it is the KV8 ECU, but also our suite of HPA tuning courses, so that you will know exactly how to tune it. And we do have worked examples in our practical standalone tuning course on the EMton platform as well. So 100% relevant to tuning this ECU. This is probably one of our most valuable prize packages to date, valued at a touch over $5,500 US. There's 8 days left for this giveaway to run. Absolutely no catches getting your name into the draw. You don't have to purchase anything, just enter through our website, and this gives you a really, really good chance to win. And no matter where you are in the world, we will ship this free of charge to your door. So I urge you, hit the link in the comments and go and get yourself into the draw. All right, a little bit of an update on the Honda KRX build. And I did talk about this a couple of weeks ago, and I was quite excited because we've moved the engine back in the chassis quite substantially, which was going to give us a really nice gain in center of gravity location, weight distribution within the chassis, and there were going to be a few other advantages with that location. However, there are some knock-on effects which we have been going through, and the team have been learning to use optimumg, which is a suspension kinematics program. And if we just jump across to my laptop screen, I'm not going to bore you with all of the details. This is an incredibly powerful, but of course at the same time an incredibly complex piece of software, and it essentially starts with you inputting the location of all of the suspension pivot points into the system. So you basically need to know their location and space. This has been made a little bit easier in our case because as part of what we've been doing on the car, everything had already been scanned using our Peel 3D scanner. So this makes it really easy in Fusion 360 to basically get the location of all of those suspension pickup points, so we can basically translate those across into optimumg. But that's what we see here. So that's looking at the front suspension. One of the benefits of the Honda, well, a lot of the Honda platforms, is the fact that they use a double wishbone front suspension. There's some advantages with this, particularly around the camber curve that you can get with double wishbone compared to the more conventional McPherson strut, which really lends itself nicely towards a race-orientated package. So a problem with this is that when we moved the engine back, we also needed to relocate the steering rack, and this has some knock-on effects for the tow curve, or what we'd probably normally call the bump steer. So this is the from the top view of the suspension, And this is the original suspension design. So basically what we did was input everything from stock into optimumg so that we could plot everything and see how the suspension moves. So there's a number of things we can do here, but we can plot the camber curve or camber gain as the suspension moves through bump and rebound. You can also plot what's actually going to happen as the car body rolls as it heaves under braking or under acceleration. So it's pretty advanced, as you'd expect. Once we had the stock figures, they then relocated everything. We needed to make some minor adjustments to the caster control arm as well as the lower control arm pickup points, but these were minor. The bigger issue really was around the location of the steering rack, because the steering rack needed to move back significantly, and this has the impact on essentially where the steering tie rods locate. And this can have a big impact on our bump steer, which unfortunately was exactly the situation we ended up with. So if we go to this next plot here, this is currently where we are. And this orange line, which is a little hard to see, but basically this is plotting the change in toe as we move the suspension under heave conditions. So basically, under conditions where the front of the car is compressed under braking, obviously we can do it under a lot of different circumstances as well, but basically this is what we ended up with. And then we've got our other plot here, which is, sorry, I've got that around the wrong way. The brown plot is our original, the orange plot is our new plot with our moved suspension geometry, and it's not quite ideal. So basically what we did was we moved the engine back 100 millimeters in the virtual world, located the steering rack where it needed to go, and this is actually our next generation plot that I'll talk about in a moment. And as soon as we moved the steering rack, we found that we had about, I think it worked out to be about 50 degrees of bump steer, which is a huge amount and obviously completely just out the ballpark. We couldn't run with anything like that. The car would be impossible to drive. But this is the benefit of some of these tools that we now have available, is that before any of the hard work of actually manufacturing components was done, basically we already knew that this was going to be an absolute disaster, so we can avoid wasting all of that time. Now, yes, there are manual ways of going about this as well, but obviously a lot easier now using packages like OptimumG to actually plot and know exactly what we're going to get. So what we had to do is compromise and move the engine back, not quite where it was, but basically we're sort of somewhere in between. We looked at other options, but extending the steering arm on the knuckle was one, and basically we needed to extend that so far, which would also affect the quickness of the steering rack. There's ways of getting around that, but I won't get too deep into it. But essentially to get the bump steer back to basically where it was factory, we needed the steering arm inside of the wheel, which obviously also isn't going to work. Ideally, what we really wanted to do was locate the steering rack in the middle of the differential for the Hollinger SF transmission, and of course, again, that wasn't going to work. So we're sort of trying to essentially fit a square peg in a round hole, and building race cars is always a case of compromise. So that's what we're trying to do. So as I've mentioned, coming back to this plot on my screen here, this is sort of where we're at the moment. There's still some tinkering to do with this, but we're way, way improved from where we were with 50 degrees of bump steer movement. So we'll keep you updated as we finalize this. We're only about 6 weeks away from our first round of racing, and we've got a car that looks like basically a shell at the moment. So suffice to say, there's a monumental amount of work going ahead. Now, part of that also involves building a fresh engine, although we aren't actually trying to get that engine into the car for the first round. We've got an engine that's in perfectly good health at the moment and producing pretty good numbers, but we have been requested for years now to do a worked example for our practical engine building course on the Honda K20, given that it is such a popular engine. And we thought this was also a good opportunity to see if we could go a little bit further and try and extract a bit more power naturally as aspirated from the engine that we've got. So we've got a spare engine there, which was sourced from a CL7 Euro R Accord, and we're going through the steps of that. Part of it is going to be really the key to getting power out of any engine, and the K20 is no different, is airflow in and out of the cylinder head. And on this note, we are having the head CNC ported by Kevin at Horsepower Heads here in New Zealand. We have used him for a number of our heads, including the SR20 VE head on our SR86. He does a great job. Got a CNC port profile for those heads. So that'll be part of that. The other element is getting some more compression into the engine. We're running a Wiseco piston, which has a 10.5cc dome. Doesn't appear that there's much on the market available as a shelf stock piston that gives much more of a dome than that. And this gets down to a bit of a compromise here, because as we make that dome bigger at some point, you sort of actually get more compression, but you also can end up interrupting or disrupting the flame front travel. So it kind of has a counterproductive effect on the combustion process. So we're going to do what we can with that, and we'll be also checking the cylinder head combustion chamber CC and seeing exactly where our compression ratio is. In the ideal world, I'd like to get it up around about 13 to 1 or thereabouts. We do still run it on pump gas, so it is a balancing act. We don't want to go too high in compression, but we do have access to a fuel here locally called 100 plus octane. I found it to be exceptional, and even turbocharged cars, which are just traditionally not limited on our other high grade of pump fuel here in New Zealand, which is BP 98. I've gone from BP 98 to MPD 100 plus, and the difference in how much timing they will take is phenomenal. So can't wait to see where we get to with that. So that will be covered in our practical engine building course, although it is probably a couple of months off. The engine has just been crated up, ready to go to our machinist for the machining processes to be applied. Now, another change that we've made, I think I have mentioned this briefly, but I've got it all bolted together to go to our machinist for balancing. So this is another change that we've made here, which is to go to a 5.5-inch twin plate clutch. So most conventionally, particularly with it being naturally aspirated, it's not making a huge amount of torque, so there isn't really a requirement for a super aggressive clutch. And traditionally, like most people, we were running a single plate clutch, which was a large diameter with a fairly heavy pressure plate. And what we want to do as well is get some mass out of the rotating assembly, and anything we can do to reduce that is going to help the engine's ability to rev or change in RPM quicker. There's a number of benefits with this. It's not going to show any more power when we run it on the dyno, but what it will do is simply allow the engine to accelerate quicker. It's really not too much different to just stripping weight out of the car. Another real benefit when we do fit the Hollinger SF transmission is that it is a sequential six-speed box. We will be using an auto blip for the downshift using drive-by-wire throttle. And the less rotating mass we have, the quicker the engine can rev or change RPM to rev match. So it's basically just going to make everything work nicer. So it's not just about the weight, it's also about where the weight is located. And basically what we want to do is reduce what's referred to as the moment of inertia. So this is getting the mass that we do have closer to the center line of the crankshaft and the flywheel. And the closer we can get that mass concentrated around that center line, the lower our moment of inertia, and again, the faster the engine is going to be able to change in RPM. It's a compromise here though, as our clutch plates get smaller, it's essentially got less torque handling capability. So while on paper a single plate still would have been up to the task of the torque that our K20 was producing, we decided to play it on the safe side and take the small hit on additional mass and go with a twin plate clutch. So that is going out for balancing along with our crankshaft. And just to talk about that as well, the way the machinists do this is everything is balanced a bit by bit. So it actually starts with the raw crankshaft, then they'll bolt on the flywheel. Once the crankshaft is balanced, essentially, they will bolt on the flywheel. The flywheel will then be spun up and balanced, so any adjustments required will be made to the flywheel. Then the clutch pressure plate will be bolted on. Then also the front pulley assembly. In our case, we're using an ATI damper, which does not get balanced with the crankshaft, so that's really important. The idea behind this, though, is that if at a later point, maybe the flywheel gets damaged, maybe we need to change the pressure plate. We don't need to strip the engine bare and send the crankshaft out again to be balanced. We can just have the new parts balanced. So that's what's going on there. Now, another part of this as well is that the original engine, if you've been following us for a while, the original engine that we had in the car when we purchased it unfortunately broke a valve spring about three races into our endurance series. So that did a lot of damage, as you could expect. It let go at about 7,500 RPM. So we didn't build that engine, but I did strip it down to see what was salvageable, and it was fitted with a set of these Molnar connecting rods, which isn't a brand that I've personally used before. Nothing particularly unique about that. There's literally hundreds of brands of Conrod, and I absolutely haven't used them all. We had also purchased for our new build a set of Brian Crower H-beam rods, which on paper, we'll just get them side by side, do look relatively similar. What you can see though is visually, they are narrower through the beam than these Molnars. Now, obviously, there's a balance here because the narrower we make the beam here, the less weight we've got, which is definitely a benefit. I've already talked about reducing the moment of inertia, but basically any mass that we can remove from the rotating assembly is going to be a good thing. But of course, if we make everything too small and weak, we end up reducing the strength of the connector rod and we could have a failure. In our case, the Brian Crower rods, doesn't take too much research to figure out that these are a pretty well-respected rod and do a pretty good job. And again, it's a naturally aspirated build. We're not going to have massive cylinder pressure. It's not a turbocharged engine. And we're also not spinning this thing to 10,000 plus RPM. So I'm not really too concerned about the Brian Crowers not being up to the job. But if we jump across to my laptop screen here, we can see we put one of the Brian Crower rods on our scales, 433 grams and change. And then the Molnar rod, which was out of the engine, 460 grams. So, almost 30 grams difference in weight, which isn't insignificant. So any amount of weight like that we can drop, I'm absolutely all for it. So quite excited to get that engine together. The worked example that I am going to do, there are a few unique aspects to this for our application, given, again, it's naturally aspirated. It's obviously high compression. We are limited to using a 2-liter block to maintain our capacity for class rules. A lot of people would obviously be using the 2.4 bottom end to gain some capacity. And the other element is that we are running a dry sump instead of the factory oil pump. And there are some differences with the oil pumps around the different models. The Type R EP3 DC5, just for an example, uses quite a small compact oil pump, which is nice and light. The CL7, the 2.4 blocks as well, use quite a big chunky oil pump that includes balance shafts. So we, in the worked example, we'll talk about all of those iterations. So irrespective if you're building a turbo or an NA motor, whether it's 2-liter or 2.4, everything that you will learn in that worked example will be 100% applicable. And the benefit with our practical engine building course is that it is generic, so it doesn't matter what engine you're personally working on. We simply present a 10-step process that you can apply to any engine. Honda K20 or quad cam V12, it just absolutely doesn't matter. And we do add these worked examples from time to time. Once you own the course, you get access to any future worked examples at no additional cost. If you are interested in checking that course out now, you can find that at hpacademy.com/courses. Remember, just like all of our courses, comes with a 60-day, no questions asked, money back guarantee. So if you purchase and decide it's not quite what you expected, no problem, let us know. We'll give you a full refund of the purchase price. Next up, let's jump back into my laptop screen. I was really excited to see the results of this. I have talked about it before. I'm pretty sure Connor's talked about it before, but this is the results of Connor's worked example that's being added into the 3D modeling and CAD for motorsport course. This is a billet rocker cover for our SR20 or SR20 VE engine. Why a billet rocker cover, you might ask? Fair question. We were having quite a lot of trouble with the rocker cover on the car previously. It is modified We were running initially a set of GTR R35 coils. It's kind of a street kit, which looks nice, but isn't really serviceable. And because the street kit was sort of trying to make do with the factory rocker cover, the number one coil, which I've just sort of highlighted here, there was actually no way of securing it. So for that street kit, I think it's from EFI Hardware in Australia, the mounting tab for the number one coil is actually ground off. So not suitable for a race application. And the other problem was that anytime you want to check the plugs, it's a real pain because you have to basically disassemble the coils through a mounting plate. So anyway, long story short, not viable for race cars. We had modified the original rocker cover to take a set of IGN 1A coils, and they were kind of mounted on the side here, and that had been cut and flat plate welded on. So the problem with that is when you weld aluminium, or any material for that matter, it can be affected by the heat. And we ended up with some warpage, which was basically making the thing leak like a sieve. The top back left corner around here was sitting proud of the cylinder head if you just laid it flat by a few millimeters. And even when you pulled everything down with the rubber gasket, it was a bit ugly. So we wanted to solve that. And of course, the other issue I had last year was I ended up with a DNF at one of the races because one of the mounting bosses for the IGN 1A coils actually broke off the rocker cover and resulted in the coil floating around and a big hole in the rocker cover and all of the oil, of course, sprayed out in the engine bay. So all of those we wanted to solve. Plus, we're obviously adding this in as a worked example to our 3D modeling and CAD course. Flipping it over, that's what we've got on the underside. Now, a few of the eagle-eyed among you might be sort of thinking to yourself, well, there's no baffling in this rocker cover. How's that going to work? We'll go back to this one. If you're eagle-eyed, you might also be wondering, well, where the hell do we put the oil? There's no oil filler on this. And that is both because this is a dry sumped engine. So we don't need the level of baffling that we would in a stock application. And while I didn't take a photo of it, we can actually see the area that I've circled here. There are two -10 O-ring ports there, AN boss ports for the breathers. And if we flip this over again, that is here and here. And Connor designed this essentially so there's going to be a slip-in plate. What we want to do is, while there isn't a lot of, well, not as much blow-by going on in a dry-sumped engine as a wet-sumped engine, we do still have the rotating cam lobes right beside these ports, and they're just going to flick oil straight out them if we allow it. So a plate slips into an area that's machined on the underside of the rock cover to prevent the oil going straight out those ports. So pretty excited to get that on and see how that all works. Right, I just wanted to cover off a couple of other elements before we move on, so just give me a second to get back to my notes here. If you aren't listening to our podcast, then I highly recommend you do so. Great way to absorb some insanely great content, and I've had some latest episodes with some really, really smart people that have been super interesting. So you can head to hpa-tunedin.com and you'll find a full list of all of our podcasts, or alternatively you're going to find the HPA Tuned In podcast anywhere you currently listen to podcasts. Latest episode was with Jimmy from Evolution Racing Spares in Australia. We actually bumped into Jimmy a number of times. On my screen at the moment is his Evo 6 RS, which he's developed into a very competitive time attack car. He is the current club sprint champion, and it's hard when you don't understand the lap times and you don't have anything to relate these to, but this car is insanely quick for what is still a relatively modest list of modifications. Interestingly, with this car though, Jimmy ended up going to a smaller turbo and a smaller manifold, and although the engine ended up making something like 100 or 150 horsepower less, the car was actually about 2 seconds a lap quicker. An element of this is the exhaust manifold design, and we talk in this episode about the design of the RTEC manifolds and how their runners are quite a lot smaller than what conventional thinking would suggest is required, but how that helps the turbo spool up, the turbo response, and how sometimes the response of the turbo is equally, if not more important, important than the outright power. And then it's a case of also matching the turbo size to your application. So if you're interested in learning about that, plus what it takes to develop and build a world-renowned car dismantling business in Australia, then give that episode a listen. Also, I would urge you, if you are listening to the Tuned In podcast and you like what you hear, I'd love it. I'd really appreciate it if you could give us a rating and a review. Every week, we pick up a random reviewer and we send out free of charge anywhere in the world a brand new fresh HPA tee, just like the one I am wearing. These ratings and reviews really help us to grow the podcast, and that in turn allows us to get more high quality guests involved so that the podcast is going to continue to grow. So check it out. We'd love it if you could do so and leave us a rating or review. Lastly, for today, one of our latest videos that we shot at SEMA, we cover what is on face value a really boring topic: suspension bushes. I mean, how exciting can they be? The reality is, though, there is quite a bit to know about bushes and bush materials, and sometimes harder, firmer bushes aren't always best, particularly if you're driving a road car, then going to something like a spherical bearing, a solid bushing, while yes, it will get rid of all of the compliance, or the majority of the compliance, and make the car feel much more responsive, you're also going to get a lot of NVH, or noise, vibration, and harshness transferred into the car. And I can tell you from first-hand experience, it doesn't make for a particularly pleasant daily driver. On the other hand, factory rubber bushes generally are very, very soft, allowing a huge amount of compliance. But there are a number of aftermarket products that go somewhere in between, giving you a firmer quality to the bush, more response, but not absolutely destroying your ride. So if you want to check that out, go to our YouTube channel. If you aren't subscribed already, please do so. And if you've got any questions, please leave us a comment. We'd love it if you could give us a like as well. And we are pretty active getting back to anyone who has asked questions in the comments section, so check it out. All right, we'll finish off by just a little reminder about the EMton KV8 giveaway. Only 8 days left for that to run. You can head to hpacademy.com/giveaway to get your name into the draw. Remember, it comes with our suite of tuning courses, so you know exactly what to do with it. $5,500 worth of value, US dollars worth of value. And remember, it doesn't matter where in the world you are, we will ship that free of charge to your door. If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.